honored to have you today. Emily is an associate professor at University of Alabama at Birmingham. And she works on a variety of topics there, while she trained at Harvard School of Public Health and Harvard Medical School, and you even did a postdoc in Europe at Karolinska Institute. And she works at UAB for a while now. And she works on a variety of topics, as American people do, but she mainly focuses her research on cardiovascular health. And I think you're going to focus today on the relationship between diet and cardiovascular health. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It's really an honor and a pleasure to be here and to present some of the work that I have been doing for the last number of years. So I'll be talking about diet patterns and heart failure, which is one particular type of cardiovascular disease, or a set of cardiovascular diseases. And I'll talk about some of the work that I did when I was a postdoc at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, and then finally end with some of the things that I'm hoping to do going forward. To start, I have received research funding from industry sources, though it's not related to this particular topic. So this is an overview of my talk today. I will be talking about DASH and Mediterranean diet patterns, how those diet patterns are related to heart structure and function, and some preclinical heart failure signs and symptoms. Diet patterns and heart failure incidence, and then diet patterns and the prognosis once people have developed heart failure. Finally, next steps and some summaries and conclusions. So heart failure is an end-stage heart disease. It can be caused by anything that damages the heart muscle, but it's often a disease of aging. So it's often a disease that people who've been living for many years with hypertension, and diabetes and other other risk factors for cardiovascular disease will develop towards the end of their lives. In the US, about one out of every five people develops heart failure at some time during their life. And it's something that people don't recover from. So their symptoms can get better, their function can get better, but once someone has heart failure, they always have it. It can be caused by problems with the heart contracting, so you know the side where the part of the heart cycle where the blood is being pumped out of the heart, and it can also be caused by problems with relaxation, so that when the heart is filling with blood, or most commonly a combination of those two. So someone with heart failure will have fluid retention, so they'll have fluid in the lungs and fluid in the extremities. Exercise intolerance, so it'll be very difficult to walk upstairs or to walk a few blocks, and a lot of fatigue. So it's really something that impacts people's lives pretty dramatically and negatively. So a few years ago, or actually about 10 years ago, the American Heart Association came up with a staging system. So they talk about two sort of phases of heart failure. So first, people who are at risk for heart failure. So at stage A, it's someone who has risk factors for heart failure. Stage B means that they have structural problems with the way that their heart is functioning, but they don't yet have symptoms. So those are sort of people who are at risk for heart failure. For what's clinically considered heart failure, that's American Heart Association stage C and D. So stage C is somebody who has structural heart disease and has either current or prior symptoms, so fluid retention, fatigue, and exercise intolerance. And then stage D is really when people have the end stage of the disease, so they're, you know, the medications that we have, the therapies that we have are not really helping, and they're, you know, people who are have severe symptoms even at rest. One of the challenges with studying heart failure as an epidemiologist is that it's highly heterogeneous. So heart failure is really a clinical syndrome. There's no one test that will say, yes, this person has heart failure or this person does not. And so the physiology and the etiology can really vary between person to person. There are a number of ways that we will classify heart failure and to try and sort of get at more specific subtypes. The most commonly used one clinically right now is by systolic function. So that is, you know, what percentage of the blood is being pumped out of the heart each time it contracts. And that's the left ventricular ejection fraction. But you'll also see sometimes where patterns of remodeling, so does the heart muscle get really thick and sort of squeeze in that ventricle chamber, or is it dilated and sort of big and floppy? Which side of the heart, so is it primarily a problem of the left ventricle or the right ventricle? You know, symptom severity, disease stage, so the stages I just spoke about, you know, is it something acute? So is somebody in the hospital having a major crisis right now, or are they, you know, walking around in ambulatory? And there's a whole bunch of other different ways that we try and sort of tease out what exactly is wrong with a person who has heart failure. So, you know, there are challenges in the diagnosis and the classification, which lead to challenges in terms of if you wanted to study this condition. We will use medical records, administrative records, and medications to try and define what is a heart failure case in an epidemiologic study. Self-report alone tends to be really unreliable for heart failure in particular. So if you're thinking about, you know, designing a study, it makes it challenging. In English, it's particularly challenging because heart failure is a terrible name. So for a disease. So it sounds like the heart has completely stopped in English. So, which is not the case, right? It's the heart is not keeping up with the body's demands, but it's not something where it's completely stopped. And so what happens is that doctors, you know, medical physicians will often tell patients, well, your heart's not working that well, you know, it's weak, and so we're going to give you some medications to try and help. So they're never actually told that they have heart failure. In fact, my grandmother had heart failure, and I knew she had heart failure based on her symptoms, but her doctor never said it. And then, you know, when we finally saw her medical record, sure enough, there it was, you know, on the medical record list. So that's something that, as an epidemiologist, makes this particularly challenging to do. And then another problem with epidemiologic studies is historically we didn't capture the subtypes, so based on left ventricular ejection fraction, because they're not necessarily very well coded, particularly if you're relying on ICD-9 codes or ICD-10 codes. And often we only capture the hospitalized cases. So if somebody is diagnosed, you know, in their doctor's office rather than being diagnosed in the hospital, we often don't capture that. So when we think about, you know, what are the major risk factors for heart failure? Again, it can be anything that damages the heart muscle, but major risk factors include diabetes, myocardial infarction or heart attack, hypertension, infectious diseases that affect the heart muscle, valvular heart disease, or some toxic exposures as well. When we think about how diet may impact heart failure, it could impact heart failure both through direct pathways or through diabetes, myocardial infarction, or hypertension, all of which are highly associated with diet. And when we think about other factors that sort of might be in that pathway that didn't go through that major one, so we've got dyslipidemia, inflammation, insulin resistance, endothelial dysfunction, kidney disease, anemia, sleep disordered breathing, heart rate, so other measures of heart function, and obesity. So all of these things can influence heart structure and function and can lead to heart failure. Additionally, you can imagine that the diet patterns could affect all of the different stages of heart failure. So both the development of risk factors, the heart structure, you know, development of symptoms, and then finally the prognosis for people who already have heart failure. For this talk, I'm focusing on two prudent dietary patterns. So these are ones that we think should be good for you. We're looking at the DASH diet pattern. So that's one that's specifically designed for the US, and it's a dietary approach to stop hypertension. It's really focused on that hypertension pathway. And then the Mediterranean diet pattern, which has been described primarily in Europe, but somewhat in the US as well. There are a lot of similarities between these two different diet patterns, but also some differences. So both of them are characterized by high intake of fruit and vegetables, whole grains, nuts and legumes, as well as low intake of red and processed meat. The DASH diet pattern in particular is a relatively high protein diet, and it has a lot of low-fat dairy, so skim milk, yogurts, things like that. And it is also low sodium, so reduced salt intake, which all together leads to moderately high protein intake. The Mediterranean diet pattern, in contrast, stresses fish intake, monounsaturated fat, largely from olive oil, and moderate alcohol intake. So the correlation between these two will depend, you know, these diet, if you looked at the scores to measure these diet patterns, is going to be somewhere around 0.7, 0.6, 0.7. So moderately high correlation for those. So they're fairly similar. So why did I pick these two? Because there are, if any, and people who study nutrition will know that there's a lot of different ways to try and capture what is a prudent diet pattern. Both of these have clinical trials, randomized controlled trials, documenting positive effects on the cardiovascular system. Both of them are broadly representative and broadly consistent with many of the dietary recommendations, particularly US dietary recommendations. Both actually taste good, so I think that's an important thing that we often overlook in nutrition research, is that people eat as part of their culture, as, you know, pleasure. It's something you do with family. So you should, you know, have it be enjoyable. And they're relatively easy to adhere to. So this is a citation for the original DASH trial that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine a number of years, more than 20 years ago actually now. So this trial was 459 adults with moderate hypertension. And it was a crossover feeding trial. So there was a control diet that was the sort of the usual American diet, a fruit and vegetable diet, which increased the fruit and vegetable intake, and then the DASH diet, which, as I mentioned, increased fruit and vegetable, low-fat dairy, and then reduced total unsaturated fat. This was really designed to be consistent with already existing U.S. prudent dietary pattern, so this is not something that was sort of imported whole scale. And it included only foods that you could find in a grocery store in the US, pretty much anywhere. So it wasn't meant to have anything weird in it. And here are the results. So the bottom line, the open circles, that is what is now known as the DASH diet pattern. Here I think it's called combined. And what you can see is that in the arm, remember everybody in this trial was in each of those arms, but during the period when they're eating the DASH diet pattern, they had a drop of systolic blood pressure of about 5 millimeters of mercury. So for comparison, if you were to take a drug for hypertension, that is about the drop that you would see for a single drug for hypertension. So this is really a pretty powerful effect, pretty dramatic effect. As a follow-up, there was a DASH sodium trial. So what they've done here is that you've got the control diet and the DASH diet, and then for each of those two diets, you have sort of a moderately high sodium intake, which is actually sort of moderate and intermediate, so somewhat restricted in a very restricted diet, a sodium diet. So this graph, it's a little confusing, but what you see is that the amount of benefit you receive from the sodium intake restriction depends on your baseline diet. So if you're already on the DASH diet, you get a small benefit for restricting sodium. If you are on the control diet, you get a much bigger benefit for restricting sodium. But for each of those, at each sodium level, the DASH diet does better. So what this suggests is that you could get most of the benefit of sodium restriction, you know, that you might get from sodium restriction just by going on the DASH diet and having a moderate sodium intake. And this makes it much easier to do things like use canned foods, which often contain a lot of sodium, or to use sodium or salt for flavoring of your foods, right? So this is kind of a, depending on how you look at it, a nice findings. And my interpretation is, okay, you could go with the DASH diet instead of using a really extreme sodium restricted diet. So this has led to the US government recommending this as a good diet for people who want to prevent cardiovascular disease. The Mediterranean diet, there's also been clinical trials, so you know, very strong evidence of support. So the Lyon diet heart study was one of the first, and this included, it was secondary prevention, meaning these are people who've already had a heart attack. And so what they did was they did Mediterranean diet advice plus high alpha-linolenic acid margarine. So this was a sort of supplemented diet advice plus some supplementary food versus a standard of care dietary advice. And you can see that people here, we've got the non-fatal, so this is looking at recurrent events, right? So this is looking at recurrent heart attacks. And you can see that the experimental diet, people lived longer without having a recurrent event. The PREDIMED trial was a more recent trial, and this one is much larger. You need a much larger trial if you're looking at primary prevention, so people who do not already have cardiovascular disease. These were people who were at high risk, though. And they were randomized to Mediterranean diet advice plus supplementary food, in this case either extra virgin olive oil or nuts, versus a low-fat dietary advice. So unlike the DASH diet trial, these were, you know, behavioral interventions where they're trying to get people to change their diet, because with DASH, you know, there are a couple of months, you can give people all of their food for a couple of months. If you're looking out years, you know, people are not going to be willing to eat food made prepared in a hospital kitchen for years. So that's one of the challenges that we face with doing these nutrition research studies. However, none of those trials are long enough or large enough to look at heart failure outcomes. So then we sort of switched to looking at observational studies and looking at diet scores among people who sort of free living rather than receiving advice or foods in a trial. So to start with, so thinking about you know, that sort of stage B, looking at heart structure and function, we were looking at a cross-sectional analysis of diet patterns and left ventricular parameters. So these are ways of measuring how well the left side of the heart is pumping. For this, we used the multi-ethnic study of atherosclerosis. So this is a US-based cohort study, but looking at the cross-sectional baseline. This was designed to be fairly diverse, so includes individuals who are white, black, Asian, and Hispanic. And we looked at Mediterranean and DASH diet scores derived from food frequency questionnaires. And then we used cardiac MRI to get the structure and function measures. So when we looked at the DASH diet score, we saw that there was a higher stroke volume, which means that more blood was being, pumped with every time the heart beats, and a higher left ventricular ejection fraction. So that means a higher percentage of the blood that was in the heart gets ejected at each time point. And both of these are positive cardiovascular measures. So this suggests that that people who have a higher DASH diet score, closer to that DASH diet pattern, have better heart function. When we looked at the Mediterranean diet, things got a little trickier. So we looked at left ventricular mass. So that's essentially how big is that left side of the heart. And what we saw was there was a significant U-shaped association. And I spent a lot of time sort of scratching my head trying to figure out what was going on here. And then with some help from my co-authors and some additional reading, realized that this is not a straightforward measure. So you can get a high left ventricular mass in a couple of different ways, one of which actually is physical activity. So people who are trained athletes, people who run or swim or do other things, their heart will expand in a way that is positive, right? It's physiologic hypertrophy, right? So it's like, you know, if you're doing lifting weights, your muscles get bigger, and if you're using your heart to do physical activity, your heart gets bigger. So it's really hard to tease out sort of what's the good hypertrophy from exercise versus the bad hypertrophy from disease. And I think that's probably what we're seeing here, is that although we adjusted for physical activity, we don't measure it all that very well in these observational studies using questionnaires, so there's probably some combination in the highest levels of the highest quartiles here of sort of the good hypertrophy and the bad hypertrophy. One thing that we did look at also was look at the very highest end of the heart of LV mass, and that really gets at sort of probably what's the pathological, and we didn't see any association between sort of what we think of as probably the pathological heart hypertrophy and the diet score in this particular study population. We also looked at left ventricular ejection fraction. So again, you want higher left ventricular ejection fraction. And here we see a very small, sort of subtle association between the Mediterranean diet score and better heart function. Moving on to the heart failure incidence, so really developing clinical heart failure, we're looking at those same diet scores. So we looked at the DASH diet score in incident heart failure. This is work that I did when I was a postdoc at the Karolinska. Looked at two different cohorts. The first was the Swedish mammography cohort. So that one is all women who were born in between 1914 and 1948, and they were residents of two counties in central Sweden. These were people who had no history of heart failure or cancer. And we saw that 548 of these women developed a first heart failure event, so either a hospitalization or mortality. Very similar design among a cohort of men. And what we, two different counties, but again, we're looking at men without history of heart failure or cancer at baseline. So they were followed up through the Swedish National Registers, the National Hospital Register and the Cause of Death Register. And we were looking at either hospitalizations or deaths with heart failure as a primary diagnosis. What we see here is unlike the where we're looking at the sort of structure and function, we see actually quite strong associations with incident heart failure, both for the men and the women, though somewhat stronger for the women than the men. And so, you know, quite a bit later, we decided to look at this again, and this time in the US, and looking at incident heart failure in the REGARDS study. So REGARDS is a big study that's based in at University of Alabama at Birmingham, where I am, and it is different than a lot of the studies that we've done in the US because it's a lot more diverse. A lot of the studies require coming into a clinic or some sort of central location. US is vast, and that means that we, you know, if we have say 4 or 5, even 10 locations in the US, that's most people are not going to be able to access that. In REGARDS, what we did was we sent phlebotomists to people's homes. So you could live anywhere in the US and be a part of this study. And we also have a very large black population, which for heart failure is very important because in the US, blacks develop heart failure faster and at younger ages than whites for a whole variety of different reasons. So we looked at, among the REGARDS participants, we looked at almost 19,000 who had dietary data and did not use medications for heart failure baseline. And this is much more contemporary follow-up. So this time we followed people up through 2016. This is really a work in progress. So I was putting together my slides for this talk and got the results from the statistician that day. So it was very exciting. We got to put these results in. So participants were followed up by telephone twice per year. And any time someone reported being hospitalized for anything that we thought might be heart related, we went after those medical records and to look for adjudication. So like I said, people can't necessarily tell you that they were in the hospital for heart failure, but if they said, you know, something was wrong with my heart, or they said, you know, they couldn't breathe, or that they were in the hospital and they got diuretics, we got all of those hospitalizations. So a nurse went through and made sure that we were trying to cast a broad enough net, so capture enough all of the hospitalizations. And unlike prior studies, we were able to classify heart failure as reduced ejection fraction, so meaning that the heart was not pumping a high percentage of the blood that was in the heart, versus preserved ejection fraction, meaning that it was pumping a high above 50% of the blood that was in the heart on each heartbeat. So this was another reason why we wanted to do this in this study, because we do have that information here. So like in the Swedish studies, we do see an inverse association. So the people who followed what more or less looked like a DASH diet had lower rates of heart failure. It's not quite as dramatic as the Swedish studies, and it looks like, you know, perhaps it plateaus off a little bit. And we're not entirely sure why this is, but, you know, I think this is confirms our findings, but maybe suggests that there's something a little bit different between the U.S. populations and the Swedish populations. I can tell you the diets are entirely different. So I think that, you know, what someone who's following more or less a DASH diet in the U.S. is probably eating different foods than they are in Sweden. We also were able to look at associations, whether these associations varied by age, and we see that the associations are strongest in the younger participants in this study. So in the oldest participants, we really don't see an association. So these are looking at quartile 4, so the people most like DASH, versus quartile 1, so least like DASH, within these different strata. So we see an interaction with age. We see pretty similar results for men and women, pretty similar results for black and white participants. However, one thing we did see was a much stronger association for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction than heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. This we're still really wrestling with. This is entirely opposite of what we had hypothesized. We really thought that because preserved ejection fraction heart failure is very strongly related to hypertension, and the DASH diet was designed to reduce blood pressure, that you would really see the effect for preserved ejection fraction and not reduced, but that is not what we saw. So we're doing some additional analyses to make sure that this finding really holds up. And we can also look at whether diet can influence the prognosis of heart failure. For this, we looked at the Women's Health Initiative, which is another US-based study, all women, and we selected those individuals who had a heart failure hospitalization. So this was a huge study. It was in total about 160,000 individuals, and about a little bit more than 3,000 of them had heart failure that developed during the study period. So they're followed for a median of almost 5 years for mortality. And heart failure has a really poor prognosis, so approximately 43% of them died during that follow-up time. We see a suggestion of an inverse association between the DASH diet and mortality, and also a suggestion of a inverse association for Mediterranean diet score and heart and mortality. So these are not very strong associations, but I think that they're suggesting that there might be something, right? Because this is a disease that has a really poor prognosis, so it's probably worth following up. And people have followed up, so this is not, now I'm gonna be showing you some stuff that was not my work, but some other groups. So the first real clinical study was a single arm, 3-week controlled feeding study of 13 patients, so quite small, who had heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. And what they found was that during the feeding study, so this is just pre and post, blood pressure went down, so that's generally considered to be a good thing. Went down when you looked at systolic, diastolic, when you looked at having sort of hypertension as a categorical, and when you used ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, so blood pressure when people are wearing a cuff outside of the clinic. They also found that the measures, so the echocardiogram or ultrasound measures of sort of the stiffness of the heart, so the, you know, improved as well. So basically the heart relaxation phase got better. So that's really promising. But again, only 13 people. That same group recently published a pilot trial, so now you've got 66 people, and they are randomized to getting home delivery of a DASH diet meal for 4 weeks after the hospitalization versus standard of care. So now you've got somebody showing up at the person's house with a bunch of food, so you know they leave the hospital, and within the day, they're starting to get these meals. And they saw some suggestions that the DASH diet meal delivery increased the time to rehospitalization. So people with heart failure are often in and out of the hospital really quickly. So, you know, about 20% leave the hospital and then are rehospitalized within that next month. So again, this is a small study, but really pretty exciting that this is something that we could do. We could help people by delivering meals to their homes. So if you know anything about dietary advice for people with cardiovascular disease, salt is often one of the big targets for dietary advice. For people with heart failure, the advice is to really do a highly salt-restricted diet. The thought is sodium restriction reduces blood pressure. You know, showed you some of the data from the clinical trials earlier. And sodium excess is thought to trigger heart failure exacerbations. So if you go and you talk to a physician in the hospital and you say, okay, why is this person why did this person have an exacerbation of their heart failure? Often they will say, oh, they ate something bad. They went to McDonald's and had fries. Or they had a big, you know, celebratory meal and, you know, this is why they have heart failure. This is why they have symptoms right now. And high sodium intake is associated with incident heart failure in some studies and with hospitalization in heart failure patients in some studies. The problem is that trials of sodium restriction, so following the guidelines that they're actually given, suggest little that there's no benefit and actually that there might be harm. In addition, people hate it, you know, that it's really miserable. Also, people with heart failure have a lot of problems with, you know, their day-to-day function. So if you're saying, okay, you can't eat any sodium, so now you have to cook everything from scratch by yourself. You can't go out to restaurants. You know, you can't eat anything that's already been packaged that you'd buy in the grocery store. So, you know, like cans of tomatoes, cans of beans, things like that are out of bounds. So that's a really hard thing to tell somebody, right? And it's very, very hard for patients to follow that. And basically nobody does. Right, people just don't follow the advice. Additionally, food frequency questionnaires really don't measure sodium well. So in a lot of places, including the US, most of the sodium that's in the diet comes from packaged foods rather than from people cooking or for people adding it at the table. And so, you know, one of the examples that we often use is that if you're looking at the sodium content of the same size can of tomatoes in the grocery store, it can vary tenfold. Right? So it's really hard to pick that up if you're asking people how often do you eat tomatoes, right? That's just not something that's going to be picked up in a food frequency questionnaire. And the effects of sodium are really thought to be acute. So, you know, if you're asking somebody what do you usually eat, that's not going to pick up that sort of sodium burden leading to rehospitalization. So it's a tricky thing to really measure in an epidemiologic study. So I think that there are a couple of next steps that will really help us move forward. So one is to do larger trials of meal delivery with more diverse populations and other types of meals. So really building on that trial that I showed you. And this is something that we have discussed doing and are trying to get a study like this up off the ground. And what we want to do is look at both delivery of the DASH diet versus usual care, no sort of food delivery, and then also have another arm that's just sort of a regular meal, right? Because one of the things that might be happening is that people, it's the social interaction of having that meal delivered. Because a lot of people with heart failure are homebound and are kind of socially isolated, so that could have an effect, as well as just being able to eat something nutritious. So a lot of people will, not eat well, particularly in that post-hospitalization period where they're still quite vulnerable and quite weak, and preparing meals on their own is really a challenge. So I think that we really need to look at, is it the DASH diet delivery versus another meal delivery? How much of it is the meal and how much of it is the delivery? And the other thing that I think would be really interesting to look at is day-to-day variation in diet associated with day-to-day variation in heart failure status. So looking at, people's fluid status, so how much fluid they have in their lungs and their extremities will vary day-to-day. Their weight, largely because of the fluid overload, varies day-to-day. Symptoms, quality of life, and cognitive function all are sort of variable among people with heart failure. And part of that may be due to, changes in their diet over time. One of the intriguing things is that a lot of people with heart failure will have some sort of implanted device that does measure fluid balance. So some of these are things like pacemakers or defibrillators that will shock the heart if it starts going out of rhythm. Some of them are specifically designed as fluid monitors for monitoring care. And so we could do telephone interviews with 24-hour recalls. When you do a 24-hour recall as opposed to a food frequency questionnaire, you get much more granular data on what people ate, so you can actually get a much better measurement of sodium, and you get a more time, a finer time scale as well. We did try this. Instead of using the implanted monitors, we were going to people's homes. It was unsuccessful because we had to time the 24-hour recall telephone interviews with the home visits, and it was a mess. It really didn't work, but the participants actually liked doing the 24-hour recalls. So that part of it they were great with. So if we could recruit participants who already had these monitors and link that up, I think this could be a really interesting way to move forward beyond sort of the traditional epidemiology studies with the food frequency questionnaires, which I think are interesting but have rightly been criticized for not being sort of specific enough. So in summary, the DASH and Mediterranean diets may be beneficial both for preventing heart failure and for improving prognosis for people who already have heart failure, so across all of those heart failure stages. We know that the DASH diet can reduce blood pressure, the Mediterranean diet can prevent cardiovascular disease events, so hospitalizations and deaths, that these diet scores are associated with slightly better heart structure and function, lower risk of heart failure incidents, lower rates of mortality among people with heart failure, and lower rates of rehospitalization. So in conclusion, prudent diet patterns have the potential to prevent heart failure and slow disease progression. I think this is really my opinion based on this data, but that a shift in focus toward prudent diet patterns and away from sodium restriction may be beneficial for prognosis and heart failure, but also for improving people's quality of life. And we're really respecting the fact that nutrition and food is important to people's culture and to their daily lives. And also that the study of the effects of diet on heart failure really still lags behind studying other chronic diseases, like MI and like cancers. I'd like to acknowledge my collaborators, including Dr. Suzanne Judd, who did a sabbatical here recently, so many of you may know, and also the funding from the National Institutes of Health in the United States and the Swedish Research Council. And thank you very much for your attention.